I'm Kathleen Hirsch, and this is Video Voters Guide, a service of the League of Women Voters, a 100-year-old nonpartisan organization that believes democracy depends on informed and active participation. For more election information, be sure to visit our online site, vote411.org, before you mark your ballot. Today, we have Ken Pryor, candidate for West Linn City Council. Hi, Ken.
Good morning, Kathleen.
Tell us about your background and why you decided to run for City Council.
Well, I think I've lived in West Linn for 15 years now. We're California transplants, basically. And I found the environment similar to, in some ways, that I'd left, where it's a community that was near a university. It had student parking. It had issues with Job Corps and young people, and a very engaging neighborhood association that met these kinds of challenges. And we're able to get, really a good relationship with the university, where children were using the swimming facilities in the summer for the neighborhood kids. All the neighborhood kids are enjoying the AP classes in high school. So it fit what we had envisioned and what we had been experiencing in our lives in Southern Northern California. And I look at this participation or this engagement as something that was ingrained in me. My dad was a scoutmaster, spent a lot of hours, drug my mom into the whole process. And it was part of what I had enjoyed. And I feel that giving back to the community is part of your responsibility as a citizen. So I've looked at the scenarios that have played in West Linn, and I've seen some changes, or not enough change, that people were looking for and being disappointed. There were signals of disarray. And I think that what I have done in past jobs, where I've been in sales a great deal of the time, worked in international with the territory from Sydney to Seoul, and they've thrown in Tel Aviv and London as well. So it was a matter of influence management, because we were dealing with smaller companies, sometimes conglomerates. And you had to get a good, clear communication path, a set of key performance indicators and way you were measuring things, and come to an understanding working on data-driven decisions that people could understand and relate to. And when you have those kinds of guidelines involved, it induces communication and cooperation between parties. And that's when you get the biggest buy-in and an opportunity for a win-win scenario, where both parties have a mutual understanding and both parties benefit from that. And I've done that throughout my career. More recently, it's led me to a second career in state government. I'm a program coordinator for mediation for landlord-tenant issues associated with manufactured home parks. And so you're always seeking to put to get people involved in tools like mediation, where, again, it's a matter of mutual creation, where both parties contribute to an idea that is mutually acceptable. And you have the better chance of getting good communications and a win-win kind of environment.
Good. Well, how would you optimize communication and working relationships between your neighboring cities and the different levels of government on issues such as transportation, policing, and social services?
I mean, those are all things that are, you know, you have to be collaborative, and it has to be built on, a long-standing relationship where the people are understanding and giving input as to what their priorities and their goals are. Such things as the IGA that's between Tualatin and Lake Oswego and West Linn, that's an example where people were collaborating and coming up with an idea that everyone, you know, mutually could adopt. And I think you have to do that on all levels of government and transportation. On a state level, you have to create those avenues of communication. And it's not just at election time. It's an ongoing process of keeping in tune with ODOT or any other social services and see how you can leverage one another and assist to support a common goal. So it's may sound a little bit hackneyed, but some of those key issues can be explored through technology such as Zoom or other video transmission now, and getting people involved in group meetings. So it's you're not operating in a silo, and you're taking in input and you're engaging those agencies that are going to be impactful to your community. And it's an ongoing process that you have to do to understand their points of view and getting them to understand what's on your community's priority list.
What do you see as the city council's role in ensuring the city's police department's first priority is serving the community, that the police department is a safe place to work, and that complaints from the public are adequately investigated and addressed?
Well, that's another area that, again, you have to understand and have good communications. This starts at the top, obviously, and you have to have a chief of police that people respect, his opinion, his leadership, because it kind of flows from there. A lot can be done to perhaps survey the community to find out what kinds of services and what impressions they have of the police force. But in general, I'd say it really comes down to getting the chief of police is doing the setting of examples and making sure that he has similar kinds of view of getting training, police oversight board, basically, again, comprised of citizens. I think we do have a first attempt at an oversight meeting. However, I take exception to the fact that the chief of police or the acting chief of police is involved in that meeting. I think that kind of hinders some of the, the input that you might receive. And there's time to get that input at another point in time. But I think it should be comprised of citizens and not necessarily the agency that is being observed and beginning to do some things like take statistics in terms of traffic stops and who is being stopped and why, getting those demographics, and again, doing surveys of minorities within the communities and schools to see how they, what their concerns are, and working with the police department to get a chief that has good interpersonal skills, believes in diversity, equity, and inclusion.
Last question. What sets you apart from the other candidates in this race?
It is that background and working with different cultures, having to enlist their help, working in a influence management environment, trying to get people to cooperate and operate within a general sense of trust and mutual objectives, and ironing those things out and being deliberate and intentional and pursuing the goals that you want to pursue. I have a long history of that, working in international for 15, 16 years or so. And all of my jobs have been dealing with multicultural environments where typically learning that people many times just want to be heard. They want to be listened to. And once you create that that environment where people feel comfortable about providing information, and you make it a regular part of your mode of operation, it becomes self-generating, and you develop a network of people that have, you've identified those common interests, and you've solidified some of the key components that you're focusing on. Then it becomes a joint effort. It's not dictating. And I think mediation is a tool that's used in social work. And it's very valuable in terms of getting people a resolution to ideas that they build, not a court of law. And people are much more inclined to support ideas that they've bought into, that they've helped create. And so when you have an opportunity to do that, it's all about, getting people engaged, and they feel that their opinion is valuable, and you value their input. And once you achieve that, I think the kind of the sky's the limit. I think there's a lot of challenges related to that now in terms of what's happening with COVID and the impact that it's had on business and all of our lives. But there's a positive side to it. Now it's very convenient to solicit input, and rather than broadcast, it is an interactive technology that will allow you to, I've been in that environment, and it allows for you to solicit that opinion, that engagement, and work towards something that is mutually beneficial, and that, again, both parties contribute to.
Sorry. Thank you, Ken Pryor, for talking with us today. And voters, don't forget to visit 411.org for complete candidate and ballot measure information.